I think there is just an appalling abuse, firstly by the ICC, which has broken its own rules in coming to this kangaroo court decision. There was no basis for it providing the decision. It was a political decision by a political court. And for then our prime minister and our government to suggest they're going to abide by it makes a mockery of the very international law values he claims he wants to represent.
But I mean, Israel's not signed up to the court, neither is America, so it doesn't come under their jurisdiction. But the whole point of this court is to bring action where it is unlikely, if they suspect a crime, they say they're claiming genocide as a result of starvation in Gaza, which is a bit of a strange thing given how much food aid has gone in. We've been told, by the way, for I think 11 months that there's going to be mass starvation in Gaza. It seems to be imminent. We constantly have, you know, another report that's going to be imminent. Well, that doesn't... I mean, people are lasting a very long time with no food, it would appear, longer than you'd expect. I'm sure life is very, very difficult. Not enough food is going in. But that's Hamas's fault, not Israel's, I would suggest. But the key thing is, it's supposed to be a court that its jurisdiction extends when there is a scenario where there could be no sort of national court action. But given that we know that, you know, the courts are incredibly independent in Israel, and we know that, you know, a former prime minister and a former president have been sent to prison by the chief justice, who, by the way, just happened to be Arab Israeli, not Jewish Israeli, suggests that this is a country which can manage its own affairs if, and it's a very big if, any crime has been committed.
Of course. And, you know, just like our democracies have the capacity to look into rule breaking. And, you know, there were cases where our troops committed some crimes in Iraq, for example, and they were taken to task for it. The reality is democracies do that. The court has no business in interfering in free and democratic societies that can do this. It's placed Israel on the same level as a despotic terrorist regime of Hamas. And we're going along with it in this country. Other countries are not. You've mentioned the US. We've been warned, haven't we, that sanctions may well apply to anyone who's aiding the ICC in this ridiculous decision. And other countries like Germany, who are part of the ICC, they will not be enforcing this warrant. Yeah. So it's quite clear we have a choice. And we're making a very bad one right now.
Absolutely. Well, according to the former chief of MI6, Richard Diller, he reckons that the government is making a lot of very bad choices. He says the government is putting the UK's national security at risk of being, says that basically the government is being clueless over this issue.
Well, I think, you know, he's making a broader point about, you know, defence spending as well and what's going on. I think it's incumbent on the government to get to that 2.5% target on defence spending.
And the rest.
As quickly as possible. Well, and the rest. I think 2.5% is nowhere near enough, given the scale of the challenges we're now facing on the global scene. And yet things like the budget have damaged this, because national insurance contributions are going to have to be met by the Ministry of Defence and some of its outlays. And those are going to be part of that 2.5%, you know, splurge. So I think, you know, we need to get to a stage where defence spending is real defence spending, not things that can be shoehorned into the defence budget. And look, the previous government did the same thing. This government should do better than that. It needs to pick up the pace on this, because the challenges are growing bigger rather than smaller.
Indeed. Can I ask you also, in terms of the challenges, about these suspicious packages over the recent days? The US embassy at Gatwick Airport, massive delays for so many people with problems at Gatwick Airport when the whole terminal was closed down. People not allowed in, not allowed out. People out in the cold for a long period of time. Is there something we're not being told?
Well, if there is, Julia, you and I aren't being told it. So,
Your ear to the ground. You know a lot of people.
Look, I have asked, and I've been told, although this is not a categorical I've been told that there is no organised plot in this regard. But you know what? I've not had it confirmed properly. We don't have the data on this. You know, if there is, it will come out, I'm sure. But the very fact that you're asking the question and no one's really clarifying it officially is a problem. We've seen problems in this country, haven't we, where information, you know, is out there. It's not then shared with the public. Yeah. People then jump to conclusions, and there is a basis for how societies start to fall apart. Yeah. We need in the modern age, we've got government. It needs to come out and tell us what's going on, not what people imagine going on.
And I just don't think we actually trust what we're told anyway. That's the terrible thing.
Well, if we were actually told the reality of the situation with no spin, then we'd be in a different position. But the trouble is that people want to spin the data. That's the issue, isn't it?
Yeah, absolutely. So
isn't it time we get back to, you know, news reporting, as it were? The government provides news. The news covers what? The news rather than opinion. I know, shocking.
Which, I mean, Alan, I don't know what, I don't even understand what you're talking about.
By the way,
are an opinion station. That's what we're supposed to. Again, not claiming to be just a pure news station, as some of them are. Just finally, I want to ask you about...
You're not breaking that story.
No, exactly. I just want to finally ask you about the British man who has been captured while fighting in Ukraine for the Ukrainians, believed to have been captured by the Russians. He's been facing interrogation. We know what that means. We know that past prisoners have been... really quite badly tortured when taken captive. Big concerns from his family. What do you make of that story?
Well, it's terribly unfortunate. I mean, for him, obviously, he does run the risk of being tortured. It's quite obvious what they've done to previous prisoners of war in that respect. The other problem, of course, here is that he's going to become a hostage to fortune in the sense of Putin will look for something in return to release him. And that is, of course, you know, what we've seen in recent times. He's held hostages. He then gives them up in exchange for criminals in the West or other factors, and I suspect he will be holding this poor man as a bargaining chip for the future.
Yeah, I mean, this guy, James Scott Rees-Anderson, he's an ex-military, as we often have the case, ex-British military who go out to fight. We've spoken to a number of people on the station who've done that. Incredibly brave people. But, of course, we know the government at the time warned people not to go out in 2022, didn't they? Because, of course, they then become a bargaining chip for the Russians.
Yes, I mean, and here's a great fear. Look, again, I can understand why people want to. They're motivated by doing the right thing. They know the Ukrainians are hard-pressed. They see this quite rightly as freedom's front line.
Yeah.
But there are huge dangers, and this merely shows you where this could end up if you're captured.